Salam sejahtera, you're with me, Rizal Zulkapli, and this is Dialogue, the National Housing Agenda, discussing affordable houses or affordable homes for middle-income households in Malaysia in collaboration with Malaysian Reserve. And I have three panellists today discussing this National Housing Agenda with me. Let's start with introducing Yang Berhormat, Senator Tan Sri Dato' Abdul Rahim Abdul Rahman, Director and Executive Chairman of Rahim & Co, Dato' Alan Tong Kok Mau, Group Chairman Bukit Kiara Properties Sdn Bhd, and also Dato' Abdul Muttalib bin Alias, Chief Executive Officer of Prima. Welcome to the studio, gentlemen. Let's start with addressing the five things that we'll be looking at in the next 1 hour. First of all, the state of Prima, where it is ideally and where it is right now, and affordability of real estates in Malaysia, or properties in Malaysia. Number three, Prima and the quality of life. Number four, market reaction to Prima. And number five, future of property market in Malaysia. And I'll be presenting these three facts right now, and I think we'll be looking at these three facts towards or throughout our discussion for the next half an hour, which is first, Perbadanan Prima Malaysia was established under Prima Act 2012 to plan, develop, construct and maintain high quality housing with lifestyle concepts for middle income households in key urban centres. Number two, statistics published by Bloomberg from the Statistics Department Malaysia reported that household income, a monthly household income for Malaysians, rose at a CAGR of 10.3% to 6,141 in 2014. And next is the Prime Minister's statement, which says that he looks forward to seeing private sector developers continue working with Prima, the National Housing Department, Syarikat Perumahan Negara Berhad and other government agencies to further accelerate towards our target of 1 million affordable homes by 2018. And we'll be discussing that for the next 1 hour. As I said, half an hour just now. So we'll be extending that to discuss National Housing Agenda, affordable houses for middle-income households in Malaysia for the next 1 hour. So let's go to Dato' Abdul Muttalib alias, Chief Executive Officer of Prima, on the first question, which is the state of Prima, where it is right now, and ideally, where should the delivery or the applications be right now?
Thank you, Rizal. First of all, I would like to share with my colleagues here that Prima actually started operation in March 2013. The board members were appointed in March 2013, and the first board meeting was actually held in April 2013. Today, Alhamdulillah, we have already got board approvals of projects totaling 153,807 units, in total of about 334 projects, different locations, all over Malaysia, of which 41,187 projects, units of projects are under construction, various stages of construction, whereas 112,060 units of projects are in various stages of planning. 560 units of houses have already been completed and delivered. Our units have been delivered. We anticipate another 300 to 500 to be completed before year end, and progressively a number of projects will start to be delivered sometime next year. Now, our mandate is to focus on 500,000 affordable homes in Malaysia, of which we already have interest from the applicants who are registered online. Totaling 1.02 million applicants all over
Malaysia. Already, there's a huge demand for affordable houses.
There's a huge demand, yeah, for affordable homes. You know, we are quite pleased with our progress to date. Notwithstanding the fact that we started off with no land bank, with two staff, but with the number of staff that I have today, numbering 220 people, I think I'm quite satisfied with the achievement that we have obtained today. But of course, we always like to do more, and then hope we can accelerate our program more next year.
Okay. Let's go to the next question, and we'll get back to the progress and also the development of Prima as of today. But let's go to the next question, which is the concept of affordable houses. And I think we had a brief discussion before we came to the studio of, you know, what is affordable houses and at what price should these homes or houses be priced at. I think we're looking at the houses offered by Prima is from 100,000 to 400,000 ringgit, addressing the 2,500 ringgit to 10,000 ringgit monthly household income earners. Tan Sri, looking at 100,000 to 400,000 ringgit property value throughout Malaysia, should it be addressed in general or should it be looked at state to state? And if it's to look at or to be looked at state to state, what kind of median or average numbers will we get in terms of the property prices offered by Prima?
Thank you very much. First of all, let me thank you for inviting me as part of the panel. You know, before we talk about your question, I think I want to start by taking stock of what we have, the country as a whole. Now, in 2014, we have a population of 30 million. Now, if we were to adopt the usual number of families, the number per family, it means that we have 7 million households in the country. Now, the housing stock, the formal housing stock that we have, according to figures produced by the Jabatan Penilaian and Property Services Department, actually, of the Ministry of Finance, the country has 4,831,791 units of houses. Now, this means this includes all houses, terrace houses, semi-detached bungalows, and the luxury housing. This means that the country needs 2 million units of formal housing right now. Of course, this does not mean that 2 million families do not have roof over their heads, because this formal housing excludes squatters, kampung houses, and so on, which I come from a kampung. Some of these kampung houses are actually inhabitable. No proper toilets, and kitchens, and whatever. So we do need 2 million houses. Now, if we look at these figures, we compare this 4 years ago, 210, when the population was 27.5 million, we had 6.4 million, what do you call, families, households. At that time, we only had 4.46 houses. We were then short of 1.95, close to that. So we had not done very much from 2010 to 2014. So that's the state of the housing stock at the moment. So the government is very concerned about this, and the PM in his speech, in the budget speech 2013, said that every Malaysian should be housed decently, proper housing. So he came up with the idea of building 1 million affordable homes from 2013 to 2016. At the moment, we have built or will be completing 180, including Prima Housing, 181,600 units by the end of 2016, which means that during RMKS Plus, kita, we need to build another 818,400 units of affordable housing if we were to meet what PM wants, which is for the rakyat. Okay? This means that every year we have to build 163,700 units of affordable homes every year up to 2016. Our records shows that from 1991 to 2000, we only built 192,000 units of all houses, not just affordable. 20,000, 2,000 to 210, we built 197. Tapi, from the year 2010 to 2014, we built only 94,400 units. So the government is very concerned. Therefore, the government has set up a few agencies and schemes to achieve this. Yang pertama, program bantuan rumah. Ini under the Ministry of Rural, Regional Development. Targeting for those earning less than $930 a month in Semenanjung and 1,170 in Sabah and 990 in Sarawak. I don't know, actually the public does not know how far this has progressed. And then we have got program Perumahan Rakyat under the Kementerian Kesejahteraan Bandar, which is Ministry of Housing, targeting 2,500 people earning less than 2,500 per month. Itu pun kita tak tahu berapa yang telah buat. And then we have Rumah Mesra Rakyat by SPMB, targeting those earning between $650 and $3,000 per month. SPMB does give figures, but at the moment we do not know what it is. Skim yang keempat ialah Rumah Wilayah Persekutuan or Rumah WIP. And this is under the Ministry of Kementerian Wilayah Persekutuan, targeting those earning $6,000 or less. Mm-hmm. Yang kelima, we have PRIMA, which was set up in 2013. I think PRIMA has progressed very well. Congratulations, Tuan Talib. You have 1 million, but I don't know how you're going to sort out this 1 million applicants against the number of houses you're going to build. Mm-hmm. Skim nombor 6 ialah Perumahan Pejawatan Awam, One Malaysia, for civil servants. Mm-hmm. Now, these are the things that the government has started. But with all with these schemes all together, we're going to build 186,000 by the end of this year. Are we going to meet the target? Saya fikir it is wise we have the policy, very good policy. Kita nak meet target is going to be difficult, in my opinion. Because A, kita banyak sangat agensi. Dan diletakkan di beberapa kementerian. Put under various departments. Mm-hmm. And yet we have Kementerian Perumahan.
Okay.
To me, in my opinion, with the greatest respect for the policy makers, all this perumahan punya masalah mestilah diletakkan di bawah satu kementerian. Pasal apakah SPMB di Kementerian Kewangan? Pasal apakah skim beberapa skim Kementerian Luar Bandar? Pasal apakah skim di bawah Kementerian Wilayah Persekutuan dan sebagainya? Letakkan satu masalah perumahan ini di bawah satu perumahan, satu kementerian, Kementerian Perumahan, where we can save on cost, we can save on manpower. Dan statistik pun dapat dibuat dengan sempurna. Itu okay. Kepala. There is no problem in having different agencies. Tapi letakkan di bawah satu kementerian. Kepada saya, itulah masalah yang besarnya. Kerana ialah, I'm sorry to say, selalunya if we compare to Singapore, orang kata, oh, Singapore is only a small city state dan sebagainya. Tetapi, you know that Singapore developed this Housing Developers Board punya program. And now, 80% of the population live in HDB flats.
Okay.
Under one ini, with land acquisition power, under the Land Acquisition Act, to buy land from and develop, do this housing. So, in my opinion, yes, okay, we have different agencies, tetapi dia mestilah diletak di bawah satu kementerian.
Okay, I have to interrupt you for a bit. We'll answer the question on the prices of property, whether it should be different or whether it should be a blanket of property prices throughout Malaysia under PRIMA. We'll address that shortly after the short break. And I will also ask Dato' Abdul Talib bin alias Chief Executive Officer of PRIMA to maybe answer thoughts by Tan Sri, Dato' Abdul Rahim, and also we'll get Dato' Allen to also say something on the state of the development to meet the 1 million target in Malaysia. Let's take a short break. When we come back, we'll talk about the National Housing Agenda, affordable houses or homes for middle income households in Malaysia. Hi, welcome back. You're watching Dialogue, the National Housing Agenda, discussing affordable homes for middle-income households in Malaysia. And we've talked about the state or the progress of Prima right now, and also the need for about more than 2 million homes for Malaysian, and how we will address that, and how the government is addressing that, and to fulfil the demands for these homes in Malaysia. Let's go to Dato' Abdul Muttalib alias Chief Executive Officer of Prima to maybe answer or to respond to what has been mentioned by Tan Sri Dato' Abdul Rahim of Rahim & Co. Just now. Maybe Dato' Abdul Muttalib, briefly.
Thank you, Azra.
I tend to agree with what Tan Sri described, especially on the macro numbers, on the state of home ownership. Unlike Singapore, where it's a 60 state, you know, you create one agency and you deal with affordable housing, and you just deal with one authority, and it's all driven by the federal government in that sense. Now, in Malaysia, land is a state constitutional matter. We recognize that. So every state, they have certain peculiarities in terms of land administration. Now, when we develop, or when we created Prima, that's the basic principles that we have to adhere to, i.e. to respect the state constitutional rights as far as land is concerned. Now, we created Prima via an act simply because we want to make it as a semi-regulatory body, but we also want to make sure that we are also a developer in itself. And we decided to put Prima directly under PM's department simply because we know that given the aggressive nature of our mandate, given the fact that we have to spread out our program all over Malaysia, and we need a very close relationship between the federal and state government. Therefore, we felt strongly that under the leadership of the Prime Minister, it could assist us in terms of the implementation aspect of the program. And that's the reason why we felt strongly that we must be part of the, under the PM's department. So we feel that the role of the other agencies, they have a specific focus in terms of who they are serving. But as far as we are concerned, we are very clear. We are serving the urban or the semi-urban folks with household income of 2,500 to 10,000 ringgit a month. And the definition of household income, in our case, is the income of the husband and wife. Now, if the children lives with the family and they are working and earning, we encourage the children to apply on their own, not together with the parents. I am quite pleased to see that out of 1.02 million people who have registered, we were actually surprised that 90% of those people who registered are essentially below 40 years old. 55% are below 30 years old. 55% are households that have only two children. And their basic average household income is about slightly over 4,000 ringgit. Now, 47% are singles. These are our, some of our basic information on the people that are registered.
In terms of the income, the biggest percentage of income earners or household income earners applying for Prima, what kind of the biggest percentage are we looking
at? Good question.
Yeah.
Now, we have analysed the statistics, both from a national basis and also from state to state.
Okay. So, but, we're talking about the state-to-state housing prices, right?
Right.
Okay.
Now, what we discovered, on average, there are 3 to 7% of the applicants can afford houses between 100,000 to 150,000. 3 to 7%. Now, we also discovered that 50%, the bulk of them, can actually afford houses that are priced between 150,000 to 250,000 ringgit. Another 20% can afford houses within 250 to 300,000 ringgit. And the balance of 20% can actually afford houses above 300,000 to 400,000 ringgit. What it means is this. Even the information I just provided, that 51% have two children, 90% are below 40 years old. That means these are almost young people, mm-hmm. and 55% are 30 years and below. These are basically Gen Y. Hmm? We recognize that the product offerings that we have to offer have to be as diverse as possible. Mm-hmm. For instance, in the case of houses in the Klang Valley, we tend to provide slightly more Sohos,
okay.
To cater for the singles. Mm-hmm. But if you look at our product, say in Sungai Petani, typically it has to be landed. Okay. Likewise in Johor as well. So this information or statistics that we got that helps us in terms of our development process,
okay.
The planning process in Prima.
Let's go to Dato' Ellen, and maybe Dato' Ellen, get your thoughts on the state-to-state approach and the very variable prices or the very different prices that we have depending on the affordability and availability of land on the, in the states itself. This is a very good approach. Do you think so?
I would like to look at it on a macro view. Mm-hmm. I won't go into different states and so on. I think Tan Sri and Dr. Muttalib probably have more detail than I have. But what I could see is that I don't envy the job or the mandate that Dr. Muttalib has. In my lifetime, 50 years, I don't think I have built more than 20,000 houses. But you are talking about 500,000 houses. I want to suggest, you know, that maybe you want to segmentalize according to what sort of prices they are asking for. Mm-hmm. And then after that, you need to probably focus which one can you accomplish a lot more, so that the pressure for the lower income people won't be as much as that. And as you go up, you know, beyond, I mean, the private sector by itself probably can contribute. Mm-hmm. And this is where Dr. Muttalib probably needs to get them involved somehow. Meaning that I would imagine houses like 400,000 or and above, or even 300,000, some of the private developers can still do it.
Yeah.
I'd like to quote that in RADAR, mm-hmm. there are 1,215 registered members of RADAR, of which, surprisingly, only 3.4% are listed in the stock market. Those that are listed in the stock market, I would say they are very big developers. Yeah. No doubt there are still, the balance of it, there are still some who are big developers but not listed on the stock market. But I think the number is very, very small. I would just close my eyes and guess probably less than 10% or so, mm-hmm. considered another big people. Now, as for the, I remember that 30 years ago, there were a lot more developers existing then, you know, mm-hmm. including licenses issued to those developers. I think there were 3,000 over of them, you know.
Okay.
So, but unfortunately, I think I have a feeling many of them are now out of business, because sometimes from the year 1880 onwards, there were a lot of the government or authorities start to change and impose conditions and mm-hmm. and so on and so on. That sort of conditions, instead of incentive, becomes a burden to the small developers. I have a feeling, if only we can look at history and make an analysis of it, many of them, I think, has closed shop. I think okay. so. So anyhow, I just want to highlight that point. The other point I like to okay. to emphasize for Dr. Talib to achieve his dream of 500,000 for the existing applicant. I think the most important matter that you have to look at how to create affordable land to do what you want to do. And I think in this case here, I totally agree with Tan Sri Tan Sri here, you need really to get the cooperation of the various states. By right, the various states should be very pleased to you when you go there and build low-cost or medium-cost, low-cost houses for them. Mm-hmm. You're doing them a favor. So I would imagine that you can look into what are your problems.
Okay.
Basically, cheap land, if you want to talk about medium, low-cost houses, which the private sector can't do. If you just depend on the current market value and go and talk about private sector building more low-cost houses, it's impossible. As you can see, if you take a study, many of them rather give up. In business, if you cannot make profit, you shouldn't be in business.
Okay. On that note, let's take another short break. But I'm going to throw one question, which we will answer after the break, which is you have about 1.02 million applicants, and you will be building about 500,000 right now and 1 million before 2018. Working together with the private sector, working together with the private housing developers, Tan Sri, maybe your thoughts on what private sectors would want if they were to be working together more closely with Prima to fulfill those numbers, and also what state governments would need, for example. Maybe we'll address that after we come back from the short break. Let's take a short break when we come back with the Dialogue National Housing Agenda. Welcome back. You're watching Dialogue National Housing Agenda in collaboration with Malaysian Reserve. We're looking at affordable homes for middle-income earners or middle-income households in Malaysia. I think we'll go to Tan Sri Rahim on the question just now. Challenges of working together or, you know, forming that private-public partnership to fulfil the affordable houses.
Governments and private sector are forthcoming. But we have to organise this properly. Everybody remembers that years ago, maybe 30, 40 years ago, we had a policy where every development, which is more than 10 houses on a certain acreage, if I'm not mistaken, more than 2.5 acres, every development must contain 30% low-cost housing. Mm-hmm. Okay. Over the years, though many of these low-cost housing, with the greatest respect, have now turned into, unfortunately, into slums, more or less, because of the lack of maintenance and so on. But to a certain extent, the government was able to contribute this low-cost housing through the private sector. Now, as far as the private sectors are concerned, many states have got requirements that need to be met by developers before they start development. For example, in Negeri Sembilan, in Negeri Sembilan, it has been put a condition that 50% of all developments must have medium and affordable housing. But they don't just say low cost. The low cost is 15%. That's 80,000 and below. You must have it. Medium cost is $250,000, which is 15%. And affordable, 20%, 400 and below. Now, this will not put a strain to the property developers, because if it is 30% low cost, they have to contribute part of their profits to the low cost. In this case, it is 15% of 80,000 and below, medium cost 250,000, affordable 20%. The only thing I would want to emphasize is that it is okay to have a policy, but you must enforce it.
Okay.
In the past, what we have done is we have given exemptions to certain developers. They can build these houses, but they must provide low-cost housing in other areas. Kalau nak buat di Gombak, tapi low-cost houses buat di Bukit Beruntung. Siapa nak pergi kat Bukit Beruntung? So that must be enforced. You cannot give exemptions just like that. So what the Negeri Sembilan has done? Selangor has got rumah Selangor aku. Selangor government, and they have given also for those development above 50 acres, 50% must be affordable housing, which also they have defined A, B, C, D. A is 42,000 and below, D is 250,000 and above. Mm-hmm. So they have given this. And there are also conditions in Johor. And I believe every state government, whether it is Barisan National Government or opposition, every state government do have priorities to housing. It is a matter of putting all this together and make it work through the private as well as the public sector.
Okay, Dato' Allen, maybe comments on how PRIMA or the state government can even work together with the private sector to fulfil the requirements or the needs of these affordable housing or houses in Malaysia moving forward.
As I pointed out, the private businessmen, they have to make money, otherwise they can't exist.
So it has to be a win-win partnership.
In the first place, we have to look at their difficulty. Mm-hmm. If they cannot make money, they'll close shop, like you can see quite a few already. As an example, when Negeri Sembilan imposed that 15% houses must be sold at 80,000, I'd like to ask Datuk Mutalib, can you do it? And then the Selangor state want to talk about low cost at 42,000. Mm-hmm. Can I ask Datuk Mutalib, can you do it? If you can't do it, how can the private sector do it? Impossible. In fact, I have one case coming to me, you know, almost crying. Only 5 acres. And he was thinking of building a high-rise apartment. But the state says 15%, like what Tan Sri mentioned, must be 80,000. And after that, another how many percent, 140. He, on the other hand, on his book, on his plan, he's talking about 300,000 over. Mm-hmm. But it ends up that he's stuck. You know, the 900 units he want to build is stuck. He cannot do it.
Okay.
Why? Because those that he's selling at 300, they have to pay maintenance fee, paying for the use of the swimming pool and other facilities. What about those people, if they are also in the same compound, paying 80,000 per unit, do you think they are prepared to come up with a maintenance fee? Mm-hmm. That's not practical. That is what I meant, you know, all these years. By the way, when I started 50 years ago, I sold my first unit at 9,980 ringgit.
9,980 ringgit.
Nobody had to tell me so many quota and so on. I set the quota myself. I set the price myself.
Okay.
I could do it at 9,980. After that, 130,000 single-story terrace houses and so on. And I built many, and including two-story terrace houses at 100 over 200,000 and so on. But if the incentive is right, can you imagine there are thousands of them building that sort of houses, you know?
Okay.
In those days, you can find developers building 10 houses, 20 houses, and he's quite happy.
Okay.
But once you impose condition which is not practical and stifling, he closed shop. Lah. That's mm-hmm. why I said, whatever condition you put, if I ask, if PRIMA can do it, then I think they can do it. No question about it.
Dato' Mutalib, what are some of the comments that you got from your partner private developers on maybe the prices or the conditions set by the state government or the conditions set by various parties when you move forward to build houses together?
Okay, I think what Dato' Allen was explaining just now led to partially in terms of why PRIMA was developed. Mm-hmm. Because if the issue of houses for the middle income is left to the private sector, then we'll not see this issue is going to get even worse. Mm-hmm. That also addresses why we were set up both as a semi-regulator as well as a developer. Because initially, we thought that the private developer could provide the leadership role in providing the houses for the middle income. Mm-hmm. But we also recognize, as I mentioned earlier, that land is a state matter.
Mm-hmm.
So you have diverse rules and regulations applied across the states. And while the private sector is profit motivated, we are less profit motivated. It's not that we are a non-profit, we are less profit motivated in that sense. Now, how we got the private sector to play a role with PRIMA under the public-private partnership is this. There are certain private sector out there who may not want to take the normal typical risk that's associated with development, mm-hmm. where we come in terms of our value proposition to the private developers is that if the project is right in terms of location and price, we actually take away the market risk that have that were have to be bear by the developers themselves under normal circumstances. Mm-hmm. Secondly, since the model that we have developed is that we will pay progressively, that actually will help reduce significantly their financing costs in mm-hmm. that sense. Now, the basis of the agreed price that we always come up with as far as private developers is this. We will compare the products that they are offering to us with a similar product in the same area. We will understand what's the average price of the similar product in the same area. And from there on, we will work downwards in terms of achieving the price.
It will also be lower than the market yes. price within the area
yes.
itself.
Yes, that, from that as a base, we will target 20% below market.
Okay.
But that is where, when we ask the developers to sharpen their pencils, to reduce the cost mm-hmm. that they are offering to us so that they can we can in turn provide it to our applicants.
Okay, let's talk about how this will affect the property market in general. You're offering property at prices 20% below market price. How will that affect the property market, property prices in general? Will that maybe help reduce it slowly as we move forward, or will that even create more affordable houses by private property developers moving forward, because they know there's a huge demand for that? Let's talk about that when we come back after the break. Hi, you're still watching Dialogue, the National Housing Agenda, discussing affordable houses for middle-income households in Malaysia. I think we've touched on the issue or the issue of state-private partnership and what are some of the challenges for PRIMA to move forward. I think we're looking at, Dato' Ellen, what I've mentioned just now, which is the 20% below market price, selling prices for houses, for PRIMA houses. Will that affect the market, and how will that affect the market? We will see more affordable houses in the future, and we will see the decrease of property prices moving forward in areas where PRIMA is available.
I think first of all, I would like to praise PRIMA and Dato' Muttalib to participate in that area. Mm-hmm. I don't think the private sector will be concerned about what you can do and how much you can do, mm-hmm. because basically at that level, I don't think there are many people who can in the private sector are able to do. Mm-hmm. I think one of the biggest problem is land cost. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, unless the land is cheap, it is not practical. It's not possible to build cheap houses like 200 and below or something like that. Definitely, I would like to point out that PRIMA really must go to the state or else, like you, what the Tantri has mentioned, you might want to somehow be given the acquisition power. So that you need to acquire the land at a strategic place, but at a very cheap price. Mm-hmm. There is nothing to stop you, for example, with some planner and some transport consultant, to go and pick up some area which is agricultural, basically. Mm-hmm. But with the ability to have the future MRT or some public transport reaching that spot. If you can get that, then you find that the land is cheap and your construction cost and selling price can be very low. But right now, as I said, I don't think PRIMA is is a threat to the private sector. Mm-hmm. Private sector will know how to do it. As I said, you know, if there is no profit, they just cannot do, that's all. So mm-hmm. suggestion may be that PRIMA look at more the bottom layer, mm-hmm. and then the private sector hopefully they are able to complement what you want in the higher.
Okay. Yeah. Tan Sri, got your comments on that? Yeah. Do you agree?
I would like to make a few comments on what my good friend Dr. Allen has said regarding private sector contribution. Whilst I agree that the main function of providing affordable housing has to be the government, mm-hmm. whether it's through policies or enforcement, that I think it's quite true. But I think, as in every country, even in England, you know, when you want to do development, that when you get the planning, there is an enforcement that you have to do a percentage of what they term as council apartments, mm-hmm. council, which is affordable one. So I think the private sector, unlike Ellen, I think I would like to say that when we did the low-cost housing, of course, if you ask Dr. Motale, can you do it at 45? Of course you can't. Mm-hmm. This 20% or 15% or 10% is supposed to be built with the profits that are made on mm-hmm. the other thing. That is a contribution. Now, look at the example of the state of Negus Milan. Mm-hmm. Their low-cost definition is 15%, is $80,000. Now, surely, after building 85% of other types of houses, you can contribute this $80,000 from at least a break-even period. You know, because you are only supposed to build 800,000 square feet, mm-hmm. 800 square feet, you know, that type of thing. However, if Selangor, for example, their definition of low-cost house is $42,000, that I agree with ini. Dahlah tanah di Selangor lebih mahal, tapi the imposition of the low cost is $42,000. There's mm-hmm. something, an equation must be found. That mm-hmm. is my opinion. On Dr. Allen's opinion of saying that long time ago there was a lot of developers and so on, now it is less and less. Mm-hmm. I think this is probably because more and more bigger developers, more responsible developers are coming in. Mm-hmm. And therefore, abandoned housing, which is also a problem to the minister, to the ministry, we have to avoid. Mm-hmm. You know, therefore, it is better to have the like companies like Alan Tong has set up, the Sandabis of the world, the IMPs of the world, the SP Steers of the world, the Eco World of the world, where they are responsible, they are big, because after all, we adopt a system of buy and then build, mm-hmm. instead of build and then sell. Buy. You know, that type of thing. That is one. Now, the other thing I would like to comment is, how would the market be? Mm-hmm. The effect of the market value when Prima offers 20%. I think there would be an effect. Because then the market or the private developers, in order to compete with Prima, they will have to look at their pricing as well. And the fact that if it is true, Dato, that you're going to sell 20% below the market value, I think you know, the price of houses in all these areas that you build will follow the trend. Because after all, your limit is 400,000. Mm-hmm. If you build at and sell at 400,000, the private developer, in order to compete with you, will also have either to build slightly better in terms of finishing, or will have to bring the price down because a little bit in order to compete with you. So I think it's a good thing that you are selling this 20% below. I hope, however, that you'll get the cooperation of the state governments mm-hmm. and so on. This is why I say that we have to make sure that all these, your powers must be increased. You okay. must have land acquisition powers in order to meet the commitment that the Prime Minister wants, that every family must have a roof over their head, decent housing. Thank you.
Okay, we'll take a short break. After we come back, we'll give Dato' Motalib a chance to reply to all the opinions and posed by the panel. Panelists on today's discussion, Dialogue National Housing Agenda. We'll take a short break. When we come back, we'll have more discussions on affordable houses for middle-income households. You're with me, Rizal Zulkarpi, and you're watching Dialogue National Housing Agenda, Affordable Houses for Middle Income Households. And let's go to Datuk Mutalib. Datuk Mutalib, maybe you can respond to what Tan Sri Rahim and also Datuk Allen have mentioned just now. And also, I just want to just throw a little one question, which is the response from the buyers, the middle income household buyers that you've got so far. I think they surely applaud the effort by the government to look at their predicament when it comes to buying, acquiring their first house.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think what I would like to highlight here is this: when we started Prima, the first thing that I wanted to understand is demand. Mm-hmm. Where are the demand? Who is keeping the statistics of the demand? Now, I was quite surprised actually to find out that we actually have statistics on supply, mm-hmm. but we don't have the exact statistics on demand. Now, when I say demand, in terms of the distribution of demand. Now, we decided from day one that when we want to set up Prima, we want to capture this demand. Hence, we decided to get applicants to apply online. Mm-hmm. By definition, that we are focusing on urban areas, semi-urban areas, typically they would have access to internet line. Now, the second part, when we look at the statistics of 2012, what we discovered was this. The total numbers of household income for those below 2,500 is about 1.9 million. Mm-hmm. And the total number of households for the middle income, i.e. 2,500 to 10,000, is roughly about 3.8 million. So that is about twice the low income bracket. Mm-hmm. Now, those category above the 10,000 ringgit, which is what we call high income, that's about 615,000. Now, if you look at this demography, this simple demography, the developers, the private developers, will have to figure out which category they're focusing. Mm-hmm. Now, are they focusing on the high end? Or if they want, they can also focus on the middle income. Mm-hmm. As far as we are concerned, the more players who can come in and step up to provide affordable homes, we are very happy. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, the public is actually benefiting from it. You know? So I am actually quite pleased in the sense that we also look at industry capacity. We understand the capacity of an industry. Now for me, if I just look at the industry capacity, and Prima wants to do this program on incremental basis, it's going to be a huge challenge. Mm-hmm. The way me and our team has designed the program is that we must work together with most of the industry players so that there's no crowding out effect of the existing players.
Okay, I have a brief question, which is looking at the average household income published by the Statistics Department, will you be looking at maybe increasing the price of Prima, or are you are you happy with 100,000 to 400,000 for the next 5 or 3 years maybe? Yeah. Are you looking at increasing it?
At the moment, what we have in terms of the 150,000 units project that we have right now, most of the products are priced between 200 to 300,000. Mm-hmm. Most of it. Only a small percentage, maybe about 20%, are priced 350,000 and above. Mm-hmm. We like to keep it that way. We like to keep it that way. Now, while we target 20% below market, some of our products, especially in the Klang Valley, the price offerings is actually even more than 20% below market. Mm-hmm. But you know, this is the challenge that we set internally.
Okay, one more question, Datuk Mutalib, which is the delivery of these houses. Are you looking at speeding up the delivery of these houses with new technology, in IBS by Sam Darby in Esdale? Are you looking at more of that to speed up the delivery of these properties?
Okay, we have explored quite a number of technologies, okay, both overseas as well as local. But I think the technology that we have discovered so far, most of it applies on landed or a low-rise technology. The high-rise technology actually is quite limited locally, you know. But definitely, we have a group in our company that we set up just to focus purely on technology.
Okay. Huh? Okay, Tan Sri and Dato Ellen, I'll give you a chance to maybe wrap the discussion and give your final opinions before we end this discussion today. Tan Sri, maybe you can start first?
Yeah. Oh, yes. I just like to wrap this up. My opinion is that I think the government is very aware of the problem of housing in this country. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it has given a priority. That is why we came up with a figure of at least 1 million affordable housing to be built by the end of 2016, by 2020. But that is still not enough. As I told you in the beginning, that we, in terms of formal housing, i.e. excluding squatters and kampong houses, the country needs 2 million houses. Mm-hmm. But that is not just affordable, all sorts of housing. Therefore, there must be a cooperation between the private sector and the government sector.
Okay.
The government must concentrate on affordable with the help of the private sector, who must also contribute to the numbers that we need.
Okay.
That is why each state government must, in accordance with the figures that they must have already in their statistics department, mm-hmm. or whatever, must have housing policies that private sectors must follow.
Okay.
Not curtailing their profits, but help to achieve at the same time making it housing development a business that can be sustainable.
Okay. Dato Ellen, thank you very much, Tan Sri. Dato Ellen.
Well, all I can comment is that I see that the problem is huge, as I said, and then the only way, if you want to make use of the private sector, is you have to think of what sort of incentive rather than what sort of policy to mandate them. Now, like Prima is at the moment concentrating on above 250,000. Mm-hmm. Now, who is concentrating on 250 below? You cannot depend on private sector for simple reason I've said.
Okay.
And if you you still want to insist on that, I will tell you, for the last 20, 30 years, many already closed shop. Mm-hmm. So if you think that you want to close them, then nobody else can help you. But on the other hand, why don't you think of some plan to make use of the 1,000 over of the smaller developer and get them to help you to achieve the target? That is a question. I just leave it like that.
Okay. And Datuk Mutari?
Thank you. What I would like to share is that when we're looking at this program, we did a consumer survey. What we find out is this. Addressing housing, provision of housing, is actually to address the question of need. Mm-hmm. But what we also discovered, that this middle income, there are also questions of wants. So if you just provide one part of it, it's not going to be enough. Mm-hmm. You must make sure that you address the question of needs, but you must also address the question of wants. Now, as far as we're concerned, what we provide is actually market homes, mm-hmm. at 20% below market. Mm-hmm. That's how we look at it. It's actually market homes, 20% below market, and we impose a 10-year moratorium. We will maintain the moratorium with some reasonable fee contribution from the owners.
Okay.
And application or allocation is by open balloting. So there's an equitable program for our applicants.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dato' Abdul Muttalib bin Alias, Chief Executive Officer Prima, Dato' Ellen Tong Kok Mau, Group Chairman Bukit Kiara Properties Sdn Bhd, and Yang Berhormat Senator Tan Sri Dato' Abdul Rahim Abdul Rahman, Director Executive Chairman of Rahim & Co, for being with us today discussing affordable houses for middle-income households in Malaysia, part of the Dialogue National Housing Agenda in collaboration with Malaysian Reserve. I'm Rizal Zulkapli. Thank you very much.